Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor, a great pleasure for me to be here in front of this distinguished group of veterans, Vietnam veterans. When you were in Vietnam fighting the communists, I was a baby growing up in Saigon. And I lived under communism for 5 years before I was able to get out. And I can tell you that as someone who have lived through many years of communism, I really understand the meaning of what you fought for. I want to take this opportunity to tell you how much I appreciate your service in Vietnam. I'm standing here today as an American, and I thank you for the freedom that we all enjoy in this country. I want to talk a little bit about my life in Vietnam, how I got out, and my American journey in over the last 30 years. In 1980, I made a journey by land through to get out of Vietnam. And as you know, in 1975, communists took over the South, and my parents actually were originally from North Vietnam. When Vietnam was divided into North and South, my parents fled to the South. When in 1975, when the communists took over the South, we tried to get out, but we couldn't. And I stayed there a few years, for 5 years, and tried many different ways to get out. One time I got out, I was able to get out on a boat. Our boat, a crowded small boat, was able to leave the shores of Vietnam for about a day, and then the engine quit. And so we was floating out there in the high sea for several weeks, and we almost dead. And we were finally washed ashore, and it was Vietnam again. So the year after, through some connection, I was able to fight a group of Cambodians who traveled across Cambodia, and we hired them to take us through Cambodia to Thailand. At that time, in 1980, Vietnam had invaded Cambodia. During the war, the Khmer Rouge and the Vietnamese communists were allied. But after the end of the war, Khmer Rouge went allied themselves with China, and Vietnam was with the Soviet Union, and they became bitter enemies. And Vietnam eventually invaded Cambodia. I left home with a couple of friends and three Cambodian guys, and we made our way by foot, by bike, across Cambodia. When we got to near the very much Battambang, that's the last town in Cambodia. That's when our group fell apart. Some Vietnamese troops patrolling the area saw us, and so they approached and they arrested my friends, and the Cambodian guys took off and run away, and the so the Vietnamese troops gave chase, and so they left me alone. So I walked off, and from there I was still about 100 kilometers from the border from Thailand. I didn't know the language. I didn't have anything in my pocket. I didn't know anything about the, Cambodia, and I never had any training in survival. But I had to decide whether to continue on or to turn around. And if I turn around, then for sure I would fall back into communist hands. And I decided to go on. It's a long story, but I made my way through. I walked for a whole day under the April sun in Cambodia. And you were in Vietnam, so you know how what kind of weather that was. I made about 50, 60 kilometers on foot, and then at the end of the day, I came into a small village. The village was controlled by the Vietnamese, but there was no Vietnamese there. There was some Cambodian troops working for the Vietnamese. But they arrested me, so I finally was arrested. Actually, that was my that saved my life, because if I had moved on, I would have sure died of hunger and whatnot in the jungle. They kept me for a night, fed me, gave me a place to sleep for the night, and in the morning, the guy who was assigned to guard me during the night woke me up, and he told me, you should go. And I didn't know what he meant. So I asked, oh, where are we going? And he asked, don't you want to go to Thailand? Yes. That's when I realized that he just let me go, and he told me that I better leave now before the Vietnamese patrolling the area, because they work for the Vietnamese, so they know the time that they patrol the area. So I turned to him and I told him, but I have no. I don't know which way to go, and he thought about it, and then he told me, follow me. So he took me for a while, and he took me to this trail that led into the jungle through the border, and he told me that just follow this trail for about 40 kilometers, you will be in Thailand. I started my long trip through the jungle. The jungle in between Cambodia and Thailand, as you know, was very dangerous at the time. There were so many different groups fighting each other. The Khmer Rouge have camps somewhere in there. The troops loyal to Sihanouk, the king of Cambodia, was there. So different groups fighting each other. I just walked on that trail for several hours, and then I ran into a man walking, a group of men walking back And he saw they saw me, and one of them asked me if they probably could tell right away that I was Vietnamese trying to get to Thailand. So they stopped me and they said that you better turn around because the Khmer Rouge was up there, and the Khmer Rouge, among all of the communists, Vietnamese communists was cruel. Khmer Rouge communists was even worse. They would kill you immediately, without question. So they told me to, this group of people told me to turn around. So I sat down and I thought about that again. I've been through so much to get here, and I know that 40 kilometer is 40 more kilometer, and that's Thailand. If I turn around, I don't know how long I will be. How long before I have an if I ever have another chance? So I decided that I would take my chance, and I walk on, and I just try to be very observant. And then toward the end of the day, I didn't see anything. And then at that time, I was so tired and thirsty. And then I saw a group of Cambodians living in Oscar. They live like nomads in the jungle in that area. And so I just approached them to, and I gave some signal to ask for some water. This old couple suddenly signaled me not to say anything. And they waved me to get into their ox cart. They appeared to me as not threatening. So. I knew that they were trying to help me, so I just did what they signaled me to do. So I came in, I climbed onto the back of their ox cart, and they covered me up with straw. A moment later, the Khmer Rouge surrounded the area, and they searched every ox cart. So I did not know, but they knew that they were in the area controlled by the Khmer Rouge, and they knew that the Khmer Rouge were around. So that's the so I was in under the pile of straw, and I could see, I could hear people talking outside, and I could hear, I could see a flashlight coming down. I was just under that pile of straw silently. And then after a while, they left. If I had just coughed, I would be killed. That couple would also be killed. So that's the that's a couple of old poor people in the middle of probably the worst part of the earth, but. Somehow, to me, they was my angel. They risked their lives to save me, and so I was under that pile of straw through the night. The next morning, that group of nomads took off, and they moved on, and then. At one point, the couple signaled me to come down and point me the way to go, and I followed that. I followed that direction. I had nothing, not even a compass or anything. All I know was that Thailand was in the west. But somehow, I made it through that jungle, got into the refugee camp. Stay in the refugee camp for a year and a half, and finally was admitted to the United States. I had an uncle who served in the South Vietnamese Air Force. He got out of Vietnam in the last day of Saigon, and he was living in Louisville, Kentucky at the time. So I chose to come to Louisville, and Louisville has been my home for the last 30 years. One of the things that when I came to America, one of the things that struck me was the overwhelming generosity of the American people. At that time, throughout America, thousands and thousands of families just opened their home to welcome refugees from Southeast Asia. They opened their home to welcome total strangers and help them to establish a new life in America. I live in Louisville and went to school first at the community college, and then after that I got into University of Louisville. I finished. I graduated from University of Louisville with a Master of Engineering degree in Software Engineering and a Master of Arts in Mathematics. And I went to work for a local firm, engineering firm, where I met a very good friend by the name Michael Davis. He was a few years younger than I am, but we were good friends, and we share the same passion for business, and we wanted to start our own business. So many days after work, we would get together and work out different business plans. And then one day, a tragedy happened in Louisville. A younger, 20 to 20 years old, by the name Mary Byron, was murdered by her ex-boyfriend who had raped and beat her and was put to jail. The family knew that this guy was very violent and very angry, and so they asked the police to notify them if this guy ever got out or was released. Somehow he posted bond and got out, and somehow this family did not know. And the very first thing he did was to come to the place where she worked and kill her. She had just celebrated her birthday with her co-worker walking out of her workplace with balloon in her hand when she died. And so the murder received a lot of attention in the media, and the local government tried to find some solution, tried to implement some solution to prevent this kind of tragedy from happening again. One day, Michael Davis and I went to lunch, and we thought, what if we develop a system that automatically notified the victim? Because every time that somebody escaped or get out of jail, that information would be put into computer, and if you monitor that, then you could automatically notify the victims without having to rely on anybody doing that. My friend Michael Davis is a very smart guy. He and I work out the design of the system on a piece of napkin, and then he came back to his office, and That evening, he developed a proposal, sent it to the local government, and it was accepted. And so the city hired us to develop the first automated victim notification system in the country. After Louisville introduced the system, the state of Kentucky adopted it for a statewide system. And today, the system is run everywhere in America, including Georgia. So he and I, Mike and I, worked in that company for several years. And then after that, in around 2000, early 2000, I left the company to start another company. It's that I'm running today. It's called IVS, and it's we focus on accessible voting. We provide I studied the issue at the time and understood that the difficulty in managing those machines at every polling location. So I developed a system where it would, at every polling location, you only need a telephone to call in and vote. And today, that system, this system is being used in several states today. So that's a brief a summary of what I've been through in the last 30 years. I have been blessed with so many good people in my life, from the couple who saved my life in the jungle of Cambodia to the many good friends that I have here in America. And I came here today with much appreciation for this great country that gave me the opportunity to work my way from someone with nothing 30 years ago to today with several businesses that and our products being used all over the country. I want to once again. I want to tell you that I really appreciate your service in Vietnam. I really appreciate the freedom that your sacrifice make possible in this country. Thank you.
Challenge coins.
Oh.
And this lets you know that you're always an honored guest with the Atlanta Vietnam Business Association.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.